Let's go on to page 18 on conflicts of interest. I just want to go over this very quickly. The Zoning Procedures Act has some specific provisions pertaining to conflict of interest in zoning. And of course, you all are implicated by that. On page 18 in your book, it is actually set forth what those rules provide. In the middle of the page, you see a local government official who knew or reasonably should have known he or she, number one, has a property interest in any real property affected by a rezoning action, which that official's local government will have the duty to consider. All right, that's obvious, right? I mean, so if the piece of property that is coming before the local government, you, the Board of Commissioners, somebody on either the Board of Commissioners or this body has a interest in that piece of property, then you have certain duties, and the duties are in sub I, 2, and 3. To immediately disclose the nature and extent of such interest in writing to the Board of Commissioners. Now, this is kind of interesting. The Zoning Procedures Act, the conflict of interest requirements are a little more onerous than the ethics requirements from the Board of Commissioners, to the extent of, now the language is very similar, the nature and extent language. The Zoning Procedures Act, though, does require it to be in writing. The ethics ordinance does not require that. So the requirements with respect to the Zoning Procedures Act, obviously trump. That's state law, right? That's not a creation of the local Board of Commissioners. Secondly, you've got to disqualify yourself from the vote. And then third, part of the disqualification, abstention, or recusal is to not take any other action on behalf of yourself or any other person to influence action on the application for rezoning. So here's the trick. You've got to, first of all, you've got to conceive or understand the disqualifying event. If it is a direct interest in the property being rezoned, that's enough. Why? Because you are therefore a direct beneficiary of action that you are going to be a part of, right? I mean, it's just a fundamental tenet of public policy that you can't have an interest in the very subject matter of an item that is coming before you, right? No big deal.
This is where I have a question. I'm an electrical contractor, okay? I don't really do commercial and residential work. I don't do residential at all. I'll do a little bit of commercial. Say, just like the sports thing that's coming. We approve that, and then I go and they have a bid process. I go and bid on it. Mm-hmm. Is that a conflict?
That's not a conflict. So long as your retention is after the fact, obviously no, and again, I say this not directed at anybody, I'm speaking to the wall, no quid pro quo, obviously. You can't have said, I know you wouldn't do this, Matt, but you can't go to them and say, if I get that work,
you get that.
Right, yeah, I'll get your zoning for you if I get that work. Okay, so I know you understand. That's the easy case. That's obviously a problem. But to the extent that you, in objective and neutral and good faith way, preside over the zoning, do your job, do your business, no influence, not sold your vote, not been influenced by the possibility of future work, you give them a zoning, then after that is done, you then, just like any other citizen, get in line to try and get that work. I don't have a problem with that. That's perfectly fine.
I've never been on anything we've ever done, but that was just a question, because one day I may want to do something.
Well, it's funny you mentioned, there's a case, and it's not in there, this is where I'm like, got you an advantage here for me, because I've got my case blurbs in front of me. There is a case where there was testimony about a commissioner who sat on a zoning board, and that commissioner was in the sand business, and was a regular provider of sand to the developer that was in front of them. In fact, this was like whenever he got sand from that commissioner. That's where he got it from. So this developer comes up trying to get a zoning for a piece of business that will not just speculatively, but will inevitably require a transaction of sand as part of the construction process. And the court said, at a minimum, it's a jury issue as whether there could have been a conflict warranting a recusal. Does everybody understand why? Because all of a sudden now, in my official capacity, I'm going to be taking action on a matter that almost without exception will financially benefit me. And that's the reason.
So you should recuse yourself there?
Yes.
I did, I mean, I recused myself one time because I did the work on the building previously. The woman never gave me a chance to build, but it was a tenant build out. But just to keep from anybody thinking of anything, I knew she had been given my number. So I did recuse myself, but I still never built anything, so. I just wondered about that. I was kind of, always kind of wondered about that.
Number two, and I want to, again, just ask me these questions and we'll go through them because I've got my case closed. Number two, if you, okay, let's say you don't have a property interest in any real property affected by the rezoning. If you have, number two, a financial interest in any business entity which has a property interest in any real property affected by a rezoning. So again, we're looking at the key, and even the cases bear this out. Financial interests are the key. Financial interest in the matter before the governing authority, before the county. And in that case, there would be a recusal or disqualification requirement. And then, of course, number three is if you have a member of the family have any of those interests. Again, the law is not so dense as to understand that some people will try and farm out their conflicted situation to a family member as a means of avoiding the rule. That's not going to work. So if you have a family member that has one of those two other interests, then you'll have to disqualify. There's a couple of reasons. The biggest reason we have to take this seriously is because if a member of a board of commissioners or planning commission member participates in a matter for which they should have disqualified themselves, it can result inevitably in the recension and overturning of the action taken. That's the key. And the reason that's a problem is because it's going to cost the county a lot of money, because the reason it's going to cost them that money is because we'll get sued. All of the cases that I have in my little blurb for you right here are situations where citizens came up, typically adjacent property owners, nearby property owners, and sued the government saying that person who was either a planning commission member, board of commission member, zoning board of appeals member, or whomever, should have disqualified themselves. They didn't, and therefore the whole process was sort of a corrupt process. Okay, that's why it matters, because you can have the official action taken by the government overturned if you don't timely disqualify yourself. Three things you gotta do. Remember, I think it's interesting, the Building Procedures Act uses the phrase immediately disclose. The way I read that is, that means at the first opportunity that you have an opportunity at a public meeting to announce, you should. Everybody understand? I would even say that at a work session. Work session is an open meeting. And if you know of a disqualifying event, you ought to go ahead and disqualify, announce it. The interest does have to be in writing. And there's been some discussion about what that means, the nature of extent of this interest and the sufficiency of the writing. And I will tell you, I'm not going to sit here and try to get into the weeds of what may have occurred in the past. But what I'll tell you is, I think the nature and extent of the writing and the interest needs to be of sufficient detail to put your fellow commissioners on notice of what the interest is, and to put citizens on notice of what the interest is. And I'll tell you why.